ordinance with the recommendation of Scott County Planning and Zoning Commission.
Second.
We have a first and a second on this resolution. Are there any comments from the supervisors?
I do, Mr. Chairman. The purpose of zoning ordinances are for the, to designate and regulate how land is used. And right now, we have very sound policies that avoid disconnected spot zoning. And the change that's being proposed would create insecurity for those in the rural area and put property values at risk. The agriculture accounts for a third of the dollars that flow through Iowa's economy. And I don't think we should put other industries, our farming industry, at risk to chase another industry. And the disappearance of the farm ground in the incorporated areas, it's disappearing every day. And it's more the reason to protect what we have in the unincorporated area. And I know that all that we represent understand that food production and water, we have to keep up with the pace of the growing population. And for that reason, I want to support sound policies that aren't short-sighted.
Are there any other comments? If none, let's have a roll call vote on this, please.
Holst?
Nay.
Hancock?
Aye.
Earnhardt?
Aye.
Kinser?
Nay.
Sunderbruch?
Aye.
That resolution does pass. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I know that Supervisor Kinser made her comments. I was going to comment after 9.
When it comes to 9, we'll do it in order as
fine.
On the roll call order.
Thank you.
I move the first of 3 readings of an ordinance to repeal Chapter 6 of the Scott County Code and adopt a new Chapter 6, which includes regulations to allow creation of an industrial floating zone district. Revised descriptions of the general intent of some zoning districts, changes to permit accessory special use permit in some zoning districts, clarification of regulations for community area development in rural Scott County, and changes in the area setback and high restriction of particular zoning districts.
Second.
We have a first and a second on this resolution. Roll call, please.
Holst.
No.
Roll call.
You make your discussion right now and then vote.
Nay.
No.
No, she asked for roll call.
Right, but before you make your I'm sorry, I thought I talked about this earlier. We'll do this in a roll call and just make your comments and, you know, go whichever way you want. Okay, is that fine? Okay, thank you.
Hancock?
No. We're going to go in order. Well, but we're going to make our comments as the roll call is, and so if you have comments, make them right now, Supervisor Holst.
I have no comments.
You don't want to say anything about this?
I'm sure I just did under 8.
Okay.
I'll reiterate what I said under 8. It's the same I feel under 9. Thank you.
Hancock.
First of all, I want to thank everybody that showed up at the plan and zone 2 weeks ago, or not the plan and zone, but our public hearing. And I've had many, many comments by email and also many, many comments by phone. And they've all been very respectful comments, and I thank everybody for those respectful comments. I probably dealt with many zoning issues, and some of them have been pretty emotional. But I've always disciplined myself from years ago, and I do it every time. I discipline myself to set the facts here and deal with the facts and set the emotion over here. And that's kind of what I'm going to do today. There was a gentleman, or maybe it was a lady and gentleman, I can't remember exactly, that spoke 2 weeks ago, and they made a powerful statement that impressed me and that stayed with me. And that statement was, once you take that topsoil off the ground, it's gone forever. And I thought about that, and that triggered me to go up to the recorder. recorder's office or auditor's office and check and see exactly how much, I'm sorry, I went to the assessor's office to check and see exactly how much annexation we have done ever since 1980, since our zoning policy came in. And so I thought about this, because this, I think this person is right that said that, and I agree with that 100% that once you take that topsoil off, but I think, in my judgment, the real culprit is annexation. I mean, we've had 18,000 acres, I'm gonna round it off, 0.17, but 18,000 acres since 1980. And it's been through annexation. Now, I know that's a state regulation, and I don't have an answer for that, but I do know, in my mind, that's where the real culprit is. That's where we're losing all this valuable topsoil, in my judgment. And also this, that's about an average of 720 acres a year, by the way. If you take that 320 acres and the annexation, the process is the same. There is no eminent domain in these things. It's, you got to have a willing buyer and a willing seller. And so either case, it's got to be a willing buyer and a willing seller. Also, I think that this zoning, new zoning wording that we have, to me, simply means it leaves us the flexibility to make sure that if we have an opportunity, if something huge and big comes along, we have an opportunity to capture that and not to shut the door on it. That's as simple as it is for me on that zoning issue. And it has to be a mega site. And mega means huge. And when we did the calculations on the $1.3 billion project that we were looking at, the calculations told us that the property that is assessed now at $18,000 a year would go up to $11 million a year. $4 million in utility taxes and $7 million in property taxes. That's huge numbers. When I went up to the auditor's office, I wanted to take a look and see who our largest taxpayers are. And aside from Mid-America, and I'm not going to mention Mid-America because they're assessed by the state, not by the county, so I'm just going to talk about what we assess at our county level. And utilities, I'm frankly, I don't think anybody on here or anybody knows how they really assess utilities. But our biggest taxpayer is Isle of Capri, which is $2.5 million, and Iowa American Water Company, $2.2 million. North Park at $2.83 million, and Alcoa is at $1.2 million. My point being that this $11 million is actually about 3.5 times our largest tax base, which is Isle of Capri. That's big. $11 million is huge. So on that $11 million plus, you have jobs, good jobs. And when I refer to jobs, I go back to my roots, and when I was in business in the 70s and 80s, when we lost 30,000 jobs here, and I'm not saying to whine about that or anything else, I'm saying it because it taught me a huge lesson on how important good-paying jobs are. They are the engine for small businesses. Good-paying jobs are the absolute engine for small businesses, and I learned that lesson hard. I hope I can share it with everybody else, that hard lesson that I did learn. So anyhow, we've got $11 million plus great jobs, plus on top of that, you have the residual. What is the residual? It's all the new businesses that are going to start and the employees that will service that industry. That's a huge mega project. That is not a minor project. That's huge and mega. It's it has to be at least 2.5% of your tax base. That is way more than 2.5% of our tax base. So, to me, it's not a frivolous thing, it's got to be huge. It can't be something simple, it's got to be huge. Probably the best and fastest way to expand your tax base is through the industrial tax base. You cannot expand it any better than through the industrial base. And again, it's got to be a mega project. I also know that when we did those calculations that I was surprised to see, well, I wasn't surprised to see, but I noticed that Davenport School District would have been the biggest beneficiary. Now, I realize that it wouldn't have helped them in their issue that they have today with the per pupil assessment that they have from the state. However, it would help them that they could, they had, in my judgment, a couple of good options. They could bank it and put it in the reserves, or would be my option to give it for tax relief, which is our biggest tax burden in schools. I look in the paper all the time, every day, and I see big acquisitions and mergers anymore. And I submit to you that it's not beyond John Deere being sold, or Alcoa being sold. I'm not saying or predicting that's going to happen, but I think about those things, and I think you got to prepare your county. And that's what my job is, to help prepare that county for those possibilities. This leaves the flexibility to do that, in my judgment. I've been elected official for 28 years, and this is the biggest project that I've ever seen come along in 28 years, and probably isn't going to happen again in my lifetime. But again, I think you have to have the flexibility to do that today. You cannot close the door on opportunity. And finally, I would just say that, folks, government isn't going to get cheaper tomorrow. It certainly isn't going to get cheaper tomorrow. You have to think about that. Yeah. And for those reasons, Madam Clerk, I vote yes.
Earnhardt. I'd like to thank the citizens and participants who attended the March 24th public hearing. I appreciated your thoughtful and courteous comments. Also, thank you to the Planning and Zoning Commission, past and present, for your hard work over the last 17 months, meeting monthly and holding 5 public hearings around the county. I credit the commissioners and our Planning and Development Director for working diligently to serve the best interests of Allstock County by proposing amendments to our comprehensive plan and revisions to our zoning ordinance, including creating the criteria for the industrial floating zone. Before I go any further, I'd like to back up to a painful period in our history when a Scott County farmer proposed to sell his land to an Egyptian firm for construction of a monstrous nitrogen plant. Some say the industrial floating zone is a knee-jerk reaction to the failed attempt to site the 1.3 billion fertilizer plant in June of 2012. Nothing could be further from the truth. The Planning and Zoning Commission started its review of the zoning ordinance some 27 months later. Now, almost 4 years since Orascom came to town, this board is considering amendments to our comprehensive plan and revisions to our zoning ordinance. Knee-jerk? Hardly. This has been a thoughtful, deliberate process. In my opinion, Orascom was not the right fit for Scott County. This was not sensible economic development for Scott County. When I was running for re-election in May of 2014, the Quad City Times survey asked, what is the most important issue confronting the Board of Supervisors? My answer was economic development. Economic development to broaden our tax base so we can maintain the high level of county services, improve the quality of life for our citizens, and lower our rates. I have been consistent on my position. As most of those who offered comments in the March 24th hearing, I too believe the new industrial development should focus on locations within our cities. I believe the proposed changes in our zoning ordinance allow for consideration of large projects if they should ever arise. I believe the criteria for the industrial zoning, floating zone, have all the necessary safeguards in place to maintain the quality of life and livelihood in Scott County. I believe we need to look to the future to assure those who come after us they have the ability to move forward, and when an opportunity presents itself for good, sensible economic development, whether it be in advanced manufacturing such as Deer Davenport Works, or technology as Microsoft, Facebook, or Google. If and when a development project is approved under our industrial floating zone amendment, we can all be very confident it will not be anything like Orascom. I believe the Scott County Planning and Zoning Commission has seen to that the ordinance contains adequate safeguards to prevent such a disaster. The revisions to the zoning ordinance provide regulations that establish the type and extent of information that must be submitted with any application for the IF zone approval. This will prevent a debacle such as Orascom. I will be voting for the revisions to the zoning ordinance for the future of all Scott County citizens. Aye.
Kinser.
I think I said thank you, and I thank you for everybody coming, and thank you for my colleagues and their thoughts. I think I made my comments at the committee of the whole, and I still stick with those. There isn't one person that made comments that are against economic development. I just want to do it in the right way, and again, I can tell you that when I ran for this job, I said that one of the things that I would reach out to are the people that work in this building and the people that are in this county for thoughts and ideas, and I think you've shown that. And I know that every one of you likes to shop, likes to go places, likes to have your children come back from college with a place to work and so on and so forth. But we can do that together. We can reach out together, and we can find a place if this site ever comes. We're going to have infrastructure and so on and so forth there. So, again, I've said my thoughts. This isn't a political stance for me. It's from the heart, by all means. And I am for economic development. I want to see, my job as a builder, as an electrician, I want to see places built. I want to see them built. But we can do it the right way. We can do it together with those that share their concerns. So I'm going to vote no for this.
Thank you. First, I'd like to thank the members of the Planning and Zoning Commission, who I believe have done an excellent job of holding public hearings, five, I believe, and most importantly, studying the issue extensively. There are several points of fact that have led to my decision this evening, and I feel it is appropriate that I let you know what those are. This is not an easy decision, and certainly there will be a faction of the Scott County residents who disagree with me. I certainly respect their feelings and their opinions. I was involved in the initial discussions regarding changing the wording of the zoning to allow us, the county, to at least have a discussion with some large economic development interests. By having a discussion does not invite the entity to start construction. It just allows us to have a more orderly and transparent public discussion. As Zoning Commissioner Dan Fortas stated, the new provision does allow us to consider should development come through. Such a proposal would have to be extraordinary, and you'll still have to play a part in telling us if it's acceptable. The thought Commissioner Tony Kenobi made an excellent. I thought the Commissioner Tony Kenobi made an excellent point when he stated preservation and the general welfare of the county finds itself in conflict. He specifically contrasted a third generation farmer and the worker at Kraft who can't provide for his family anymore because he lost his job. It is clear to me that those in opposition believe this is an eminent domain issue. The letters and emails I received have chastised us, the supervisors, because we supervisors are taking their land away. That is simply not true. Commissioner Lynn Gibson compared the 10% of ag loaners with 90% of the county residents. That's my conscience, she said. And Commissioner Carolyn Scheibe, a 16-year veteran on the planning and zoning, stated very much my feeling. She said, I'm not scared at all that the zoning change will invite industry to the county. I believe we have upped the requirements. One lady, Ms. Francione, I believe, was perplexed at the public hearing March 24th because she had never heard of any reason for economic development efforts in our county. The reason is revenue. We at the county don't make widgets and sell them at profit. We spend our citizens' tax dollars and fees. When development such as Orascom comes to our county, it means significant revenue. Orascom would never have been allowed to come to Scott County. We scheduled three public hearings, and they caused us to postpone every hearing because they knew they could not meet our requirements as well as the legal issues they would face with spot zoning. But to answer the question more specifically, Orascom would have been required to pay a significant amount of dollars in taxes every year, and also a few million dollars in utilities every year. Just think what that could have done for our school system, which is desperate for funds. If I felt we supervisors would be responsible for the selling of farmland because of floating industrial zoning designation, I would be strongly opposed to the IF zoning. But that is not the case. In fact, I'm disappointed that we supervisors are being accused of selling prime farmland against the will of the farmer. We, the county, own no farmland. The owner is the farmer. If you don't want industry on your prime farmland, don't sell it to whoever wants to purchase it. It's my understanding that the Heinz Craft site, the first one they chose, the owner wouldn't sell. They went to the second site. If the ownership will not sell the land, then the land cannot be purchased by industry. I believe in individual rights. So in my opinion, if a farmer wants to sell his land, he should be allowed to do so. But do not blame the county for that sale. My decision, Mr. Chairman, I vote to support the recommendation of Commissioners Scheibe, Gibson, Schnecklaw, Cordes, Kenobi, Finley, and Lloyd, and vote yes for the industrial floating zone. Thank you.
I move the resolution approving the bid and awarding the contract for the Sheriff Patrol Headquarters Construction Testing Service, Team Service, in the amount of $22,300.